For more on the Republican Party's ideological purge, I'm joined by Michael Steele, the former chair of the Republican National Committee. I want to start there, Michael, because what's so strange about this is that there is no ideological sin that has been committed here.
Right.
She didn't vote against the party on some big bill. I mean, Arlen Specter, right? Arlen Specter votes for the Recovery Act. Mm-hmm. And he basically, this is when you were at the RNC, I think.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
He basically gets shown the door. But at least there you could say, look, we oppose this policy, and that's a line we can't cross. And so he's booted. This is literally about, does the sun rise in the east?
It is. And I had dinner with the senator when that occurred to talk about.
Did you tell him? Vote? Were you like, dude, you're gone?
Like dude, no. That goes to some fundamentals. This does not. And I love the way you set this up. I was taking notes, like in class. Authoritarian delusion leads to ideological purges, which animate democratic centralism. That's what you basically laid out as the 21st century iteration of the Republican Party. And that's how it's manifesting itself right now in what's about to happen to Liz Cheney. She's done nothing wrong other than to speak truth to power. She's done nothing wrong other than to acknowledge what every other American who participated in and watched the election of 2020 know to be true, that Donald Trump lost. And she said to the party, we as a party should not continue to pursue this big lie. We should not lie to the American people. And for that, she's going to lose her position of authority. And that speaks, and I'm just finishing up, that speaks to this idea of this democratic centralism, that now we are all of one thought and one mind, and that all depends on what Donald Trump thinks we should be about.
No, it really is like, it's the original meaning, that line, the party line. Like, the party line is now Donald Trump won the election, it was stolen from him, and you can't get anywhere crossing the party line.
Right.
That's what the party line is. And it's, you know, in terms of who she is, I mean, this is not, again, this is a person who is a hard right member of Congress. This is not a squish. This is not a rhino. This is not a moderate in any way, shape, or form.
That's right.
Which is what's so striking to me, because what the litmus test is has moved away from any plausible ideological account to simply this one about basically Donald Trump.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't matter. I mean, you know, if Liz Cheney had come out and said that, you know, she was now embracing a pro-choice view on abortion, or that she, as you noted in the opening, is now behind Biden's increase of taxes on the wealthy, that's one of those ideological fault lines in which the leadership would say, hey, come on, you know, let's huddle up for a minute, let's talk about it. But this is being dictated to her not along those ideological lines, but along the purely sort of cosmetic, unimportant, you know, idea that Donald Trump somehow is still in charge of things, and that we are so afraid of him still that this we have to do. In other words, if we keep you on board, then we'll see it impact us in our primaries, impact us in our fundraising, impact us in other messaging. Go ahead.
Well, I didn't mean to cut you off. Just, I know that you are, if I'm not mistaken, I think you're Jesuit educated. And I think that...
Augustinian,
sorry. You know, there's also, you know, it'll affect in those practical ways, but there's a moral rot that's happening here.
Yeah.
That is also, and it's something that Orwell documents in all of those books, which is that the party can coerce you to publicly avow things, but no one actually believes it. And it's like, that's what's so messed up here, too. Behind closed doors, I bet a majority of the caucus agrees with Liz Cheney. And in fact, when they took the secret ballot vote, she won 145-61. So that it's even more pernicious because they all know she's right. They're just going to go and be part of the show trial in front of everyone to toe the party line.
You raise an interesting a point to sort of focus on, because there was a time when this type of tension within the caucus would play itself out. The members pretty much said, okay, you can go off and just do what you need to do because you have to stand where you are because of the constituents in your community who support you and who, you know, puts you in office. And they would give you a wide berth, whether it was on policy issues like a tax bill or something like that, or on political issues where the party wanted to say or move in a particular direction, but you, given the fact that you were voted on or, you know, put in office by a constituency that's not buying that, were allowed to stay there in that space. Today, that's no longer the case. You all have to huddle up and move with the herd in one direction, which is over a cliff. And she's sitting there going, hey, stupid, that's a cliff. there is nowhere but down on the other side of that.
Yeah.
Let's turn this around and move in a new direction. She's not allowed to do that as she once would have been allowed under a different setting inside the party.
So I don't want to overstate, they made a run at her earlier, right? And she won that vote well, 145-61. To me, my sense is that this is different terrain now when you have McCarthy, who's leadership. You've got Stefanik, you've got people whipping, and McCarthy's hot mic moment, which again, like, I'm sure he's so bummed out they caught him saying this. Am I wrong to think, like, they're basically saying she's done?
Yeah, she's done. She's done. And in fact, I look for McCarthy. I mean, he's already signaled that to signal further. He wants to go back to Mar-a-Lago and report.
Right.
I did what you wanted me to do.
Right.
Can we just call the thing what it is? Right.
Yep.
He wants to be able to go back to Mar-a-Lago and say, hey, boss, we got rid of her. Because that's, remember what Trump said the last time he was down that way. He raised the question of why she's still in leadership. And isn't it interesting that some 6-8 weeks later, here we are, and they're about to oust her. But here's the rub. Go ahead and do what you want to do, boo. That's okay. You go ahead and kick her out. But know this, that when you do, she becomes a galvanizing reminder to the rest of the country of what this party is, not what it's become, but what it now is.
Yeah.
And that you have to carry with you in election after election after election. It's not just about Donald Trump and Liz Cheney. It's about how you treat a woman who speaks her mind. And we heard the references that some members have made to her about being, well, she's the, you know, that girlfriend that you have a problem with, right?
Yeah.
All of that is now fodder for the upcoming cycle. And Liz will be the tip of that spear.
Yeah. We're going to see. So far, they feel no compunction to course correct. And I don't even know if they're wrong, given the sort of structural factors at play. Michael Steele, that was enlightening. Thank you very much.